An estimated 23 million people have been displaced by natural disasters every year since 2010. That's according to the World Meteorological Organization. While it's not an official designation, some call climate-induced migrants climate refugees. And as rising sea levels, destructive floods, droughts, and wildfires threaten communities in the U.S. and across the globe, some say governments need to prepare for more migration. Joining us to discuss climate-induced migration and what it means for the U.S. are Sabina Scheck, director of the University of Chicago's Program on Global Environment, and Kathleen Arnold, director of DePaul University's Refugee and Forced Migration Studies Program. Sabina, let's start with you. What does the term climate change refugee mean?
Hi, I think that was question was for me. Sorry,
yes.
I couldn't hear you before. Thanks. I think the term refugee as defined formally by the United Nations is of a person who's crossed international borders out of fear of persecution or disruption. Climate refugee, the term is not formally acknowledged under this definition, since a lot of the movement we see in response to climate change is internal within borders or secondary, causes secondary displacement. But aside from the technicality, I think when we hear the term climate refugee, we're talking about the mounting evidence of movement both within and across borders due to climate hazards, but also accumulated events and chronic conditions caused by climate change. Just quickly, regardless of that terminology, I think it's critical to recognize that the burden of these climate hazards is unequal, and there's wide differences in how it affects people across countries, within a country, even across neighborhoods within a single city, partly due to geographic conditions, but really an outcome of deeper-rooted inequalities that make certain populations more vulnerable to climate change and displacement.
And just briefly there, when you say populations, are these people of color? Is it particularly impoverished individuals? Or I'm thinking a lot of rich folks have homes along shorelines that are getting flooded out, for example. So can you explain?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that there's a confluence of factors that will influence how people are affected by climate change. And certainly, it may be that exposures to the hazards may be different for different people, but it's really the what happens after the hazard as well. So I think that there's, unequal economic conditions, lack of political representation, racial inequities, and different social structures. All of these things matter significantly. So, I think I heard something about infrastructure in that last segment, and that's something where we have to think really broadly, beyond the idea of gray physical construction and consider these differences and infrastructure is defined as economic and technological, natural and social infrastructure so that climate change planning doesn't further exacerbate inequality in either in its design or its outcomes.
And let's put this further into perspective. Since 2008, about 318 million people around the world have been displaced by climate disasters. That's according to the Internal Displacement Monitoring Center. That includes 156 million people displaced by floods, 119 million people by storms, and 33.5 million individuals displaced by earthquakes. Now, Kathleen, let's bring you in. What are the reasons that people are displaced? Is it in the immediate aftermath of these disasters, or is it more cumulative effects?
Yeah, I mean, I think climate change, and in certain respects, has happened very quickly, but there's also a very slow process by which people have been affected. We have enough warning signs. The aftermath is certainly important, especially the degree to which we have been over vetting refugees and kind of building walls against migrants. But as Sabina and I were talking earlier, and most migration happens internally. There's quite a lot we could do to ensure that the ecosystem isn't destroyed, that toxic waste dumping doesn't occur to the degree that it is occurring. And it definitely disproportionately affects, as Sabina just said, people who are poorer. Very often women gather water, for example, women and children, they have difficulties getting water. They're also disproportionately affected if some sort of disaster occurs because climate refugee displacement doesn't just occur because of big disasters, but also kind of slow accumulating ones. And so very often people who have very little resources for mobility and so on and so forth are going to be stuck, whereas the rich people you just referred to will be able to move more easily.
No, this is, of course, happening globally, but as well internally within the United States. Are there particular areas of the country, or are we even seeing any examples of this in the Chicago area? And I will pose that question to you, Sabina.
Okay, sure. You know, I think in the U.S., there's a lot of speculation that people will migrate to water-rich or climate-protected areas, you know, those who can anyway, and those who have the ability to move. I don't think it's, you know, entirely evident at the moment that this is sort of some kind of permanent movement, as cities with the highest population growth are places with high exposure to coastal and heat hazards rather than places in the Midwest right now. But I think we're seeing more of the impact of climate change on housing, on transit systems, certainly on energy and water infrastructure, and all of these are going to play into future population movement.
Almost counterintuitive there, where you're seeing those population explosions. Kathleen, conversely, is Chicago prepared to handle if there is an influx of climate refugees? Is this something the city is preparing for and able to prepare for?
I mean, Chicago is certainly, they seem to be authorizing new construction in my neighborhood and in other neighborhoods. To me, that's a bit chilling. Obviously, we need, I think, more unification as a country on this so that we don't have this kind of vision of people kind of rushing into Chicago, because that's almost like the fear of climate-induced migration from abroad. But yeah, I think there's quite a lot going on the West Coast, right, that would be concerning. I don't think they're going to immediately move here, but we do need to kind of unify as a country and also internationally, including with the infrastructure bill you were just talking about, right? I've just read that they dropped a number of green-friendly proposals from that bill to get it passed. And that's not great messaging. It shouldn't be a trade-off. This is something that's urgent, but it's not going to lead to hordes or masses of people rushing to Chicago, I don't think, yet.
And Sabina, we only have about 30 seconds left, but what needs to be done further? We've talked about a lot of this already, but to further address climate-related migration, is there a very quick example you could give us?
Well, I think that, you know, when you're talking about Chicago, the city and the region can be well-positioned to attract investment related to water resources and to, you know, attract people to Chicago. But I think a lot of it depends on how we plan and manage freshwater, but also climate hazards like urban flooding and heat. And all of this is related to resilient infrastructure and in housing, education, you know, furthering programs for racial justice and natural resource protection. I think those are all really part of this picture.
Thank you so much to Sabina Sheck and also Kathleen Arnold.
Thank you.